We turn mics on. Start.
Tell me what to do, and I'll do it.
Why that way?
About switching the flavor.
Somebody said it's supposed to be on that side of the room. Whatever.
All right, let's call the meeting to order. Stand for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, I have a few items to add to the agenda.
That's 3.5 pages. I think it's one of the longest I've ever seen.
Okay, first item, the municipal center. So I want these just added to the end of the agenda.
Okay.
In this order, municipal center, an update on the ball courts, but let's put that under item 24 with the playground update. Street lights, I had an additional detail regarding the town's A fund and just street lights in general. So just add a subsection for number 10. Next item is an update on the Bridge New York culvert replacement grants that we applied for. So I can provide details on those four locations.
That goes to the end? Or is that a certain number on the agenda related to?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
That goes to the end of the agenda, or is that we add that to another item?
No, let's add that at the end.
Right, what was that again?
We're going to call that Bridge New York Culvert Replacement Grant Applications. The next item to be added at the end is I'm looking for authorization from the board so I can change the contract regarding the water line replacement across the Carmine Liberta Bridge. Item after that is, I just wanted to fill you in, we should anticipate a maintenance agreement from the county regarding the overlook next to the Carmine Liberta Bridge. And item after that, a very short discussion on the concept of a proposed zoning change for properties along the rail trail between Water Street and Plains Road. And after that, this is related to our public hearing tonight for section 212.23. A couple of items related to that, and that is all I had.
Is there any time urgency about proposed zoning change between Water Street and Plains Road? Would I like to get some documentation or information before we discuss that? It's a little
I'm just introducing the concept.
Okay.
Gotta start somewhere.
I'd like to add a discussion about the use of social media polls to gather further public input on projects going forward.
Generally. Okay.
It's the kind of thing, if we're having a late night, we can always push it back to the next meeting. It's not time sensitive, but it is something I'd like to discuss.
Okay. I'd like to make a motion to accept the agenda as amended.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
So we have an announcement. On Friday, we got all the staff together and we had lunch in the DPW garage. with clerk's office, building department, public works folks, and we were there because we were celebrating the fact that our superintendent of public works, Lou Terwilliger, and Nick Cottingham have completed last Friday on September 9th, 25 years of service with the village, and it was a nice event, and we wanted to thank them again publicly at this meeting for their service, and it's really a pleasure working with those two gentlemen.
I would like to add my own note, since I missed the celebration.
I was not
in the village, but I wanted to be known that I agree that we owe them a great deal. They've done fantastic work for 25 years. And I hate the word fantastic, but these two guys and the DPW have done extraordinary work for the village. And I sometimes feel that if we all went away, the village would keep functioning. Because the streets would be clean, the water would be in, the sewage would be out, and there would be still a fire department, a police department, and everything would be pretty much the way it should be.
You here?
Anybody else want to comment?
No, I just thought that it was very interesting that although they've been here that long, both of them are in their 40s, so we can probably expect them to be here another 10 years before they're eligible for early retirement.
Yeah. And I commented on Friday, one of the things that I really appreciate about both of them is they have a ton of historical references, and I go to them regularly with different ideas, and I'm sure they're very experienced with hearing mayors come up with this idea or that idea, and they're great at listening and diplomatically saying, you know what, been there, done that, that doesn't work for this reason or that reason, or if you do come up with an idea, they're very willing to try new things. So they just create a really nice culture, a great working environment, and I think that permeates across that public works department and into the other departments. So I thank them for working hard and creating a nice culture. Anyone here for public comment? Okay. Alex, are we opening this public hearing regarding the adoption of local law amending chapter 212.23, or are we opening it for the first time? Do you know?
This is the first time.
Okay, so I'd like to make a motion that we open this public hearing. And it's regarding site plan review thresholds within the zoning portion of our code.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Discussion. I'm afraid that it's really consideration of the adoption of a local law amending 212.13 rather than 23. So I'm concerned that we get that right. And there is a reference in the text of 212.13 to 212.23, which you'll remember I confused, or we got a typo one time, and that had to be corrected. So it's unfortunate that it might have been corrected twice, once where it didn't need to be corrected.
But I think we're fine, because if you look at the notice, it was noticed as amending chapter 212.13. I think merely a typo on our agenda.
I agree, so I just want that to be clear.
Thank you. So I'd like to make a motion to continue to keep the public hearing open. I don't know if I need to make a motion or if we just keep it open.
We'll just keep it open.
Keep it open, yeah. Okay. So. Let's move to the consent agenda. I motion that we accept the consent agenda.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. You know what we can do first is the adoption of the resolution. Linda, if you wanted to come to the table and
Uh, Hi, good evening. My name is Linda Geary, and I first wanted to really thank the Village Board for last month when I came here to ask for permission to plant something in the Peace Garden, Peace Park, in remembrance of Maya Gold's life. Everything hadn't really been thought through as far as what should be planted and where. And as long as you're honoring Blue Terwilliger, I'd like to add my two cents. He was extremely cooperative with me, as was Vicki Danskin. They both made time for me, accommodated me to come and look at the park. And the process actually ended up being a much better idea than what we had originally thought. And you know, originally we wanted to plant bulbs, and then now, as it turns out, based on Vicki's suggestion and Blue finding a good spot, the idea is to plant a weeping cherry in Peace Park. And I have to share with you that Elise, Maya's mother, whose sister was killed when she was 11, had a weeping cherry planted at her grave in Queens, which was unbeknownst to me. And so it was sort of this magical process of going around and turning the ball and turning the ball and looking, because we were originally thinking of a dogwood or a redbud, and then Vicki came up with weeping cherry. So I just wanted to add that as something that kind of gave me the chills and was very meaningful to Elise when I told her it would be a weeping cherry. So anyway, as to the resolution that is before you is to allow friends and family of Maya Gold to plant a tree, a miniature or a dwarf cherry tree in the Friendship Garden inside of Peace Park. We'd like to do it on October 1st, probably around 2 o'clock. Originally, I had drafted for the Village Board's review a resolution that included making October 2nd a day of remembrance for Maya. And in the interest of simplifying the effort and moving forward with a calm and peaceful approach, I modified it just to have it as a tree in the park. The fact is, for many people, it will be a day of remembrance anyway, regardless of whether any town board approves it as such or not, or village board. So that's really all I have to say. If anybody has any questions about it, I think the resolution speaks for itself. And I really appreciate, and the family really appreciates, on behalf of the family, I would like to thank the village board very much.
Thanks for your work on this, Linda.
Thanks, Linda. And I think it'll be a great addition to Peace Park to have this new planting to commemorate peace and issues that were very important and resonated with Maya. So that'll be a great addition to Peace Park. So I'd like to make a motion that we accept the resolution.
Second.
All in favor?
Can we have some discussion first?
Sure. Here, use the mic.
So, all of our board received some correspondence in the last few days regarding any potential dangers that may come from doing this, and I am very much in support of doing this, especially given the fact that we indicated we were going to support this last month. But I do think that going forward, maybe we should have a policy, and hopefully the situation never arises again. But I would like to be more prepared, perhaps, the next time it comes around. So I would like to draft a policy for future instances not involving this.
Okay.
So that's my piece, and I'll shut up.
Okay, so show of hands regarding this resolution. All in favor?
Aye.
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 So that was agenda item 27. We moved that forward just so you guys could escape our warm attic.
Next week at Ray's will be here.
Right. And I just checked October 1st is a Saturday, which I'm sure you already know.
So Jack, we were going to chat with you. We were going to step into the other room for the purposes of interviewing you for your interest in serving on the Environmental Policy Board. So let's step across the hall.
So you're in the right place, you know, as the village board meeting.
They're just in a... How you doing? So we're just interviewing a couple of folks. We'll be back up.
Oh, we're here. You guys.
You can just grab a seat there.
Okay.
This is Karen. Hey, Karen.
Hi.
Is okay, so?
Yeah. Do you want to chat about the landlord-tenant council? That'd be great. You can come downstairs with me.
No sign of Jennifer?
Wait, what?
No sign of Jennifer?
Not yet.
Okay.
I'd like to motion that we appoint Jack Murphy to the Environmental Policy Board.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. And then
thank you.
We've had this discussion before about trying to figure out a way to give the Village Board authorization or discretion to appoint non-village residents to committees or commissions or boards. And we haven't quite figured out how to handle that yet. So I think we just have a challenge with your existing residency.
Yeah.
Being on Holland Lane, you're not in the village, even though you could throw a rock into the village from Holland. So we'd love to circle back with you.
Okay. So, Neil.
And then we had another interview, Jennifer Wells, an applicant for the Affordable Housing Board. I believe she's on her way, so when she arrives, we'll try to chat with her then. So let's move on to item 4 of our business agenda. We're going to speak with Frank Getchell, a hydrogeologist. Frank, if you want to join us at the table.
I brought Karen Benson.
Great. The challenge with our system is you have to speak directly into the mic because the meeting is being recorded, and otherwise the audio won't be picked up, and folks are watching this on public access TV, and then they're watching it later. We have really high ratings. I'm not kidding.
So I hope I don't ruin your Wednesday.
Just move that mic down.
Hope I don't ruin your Wednesday evening ratings. That's for sure. good evening. I'm Frank Getchell, and this is Karen Benson. We're with Leggett, Preshears, and Graham. We're both hydrogeologists, and an invite was extended to us to come and speak with you this evening about groundwater resources and supply development. And specifically with respect to your upcoming needs relative to having to get off the tunnel and then beyond that. Just as a way of introduction, our firm has been around since 1944. We've done a lot of the water supply, groundwater related work pretty much in this region since that time. We did work back, was it in the 50s back in? In the 1950s actually. Some of that work was actually with Villa Bernier and Larios as a sub. And we more recently completed work last year with Hazen and Sawyer as part of their work that was commissioned by the City of New York. I believe it was actually for you folks. So I was a little confused because I always get the town and the village mixed up, so my apologies. I hope no one takes offense with that. Okay. Okay. Time really flies.
Yes.
But we're actually involved with a similar project down in New Windsor for the same purposes. So I guess where I just wanted to go briefly, I did bring a map just to kind of, just as a point of reference. I don't know if it's of any benefit to put it out there or not. So I'll leave it in here for the time being. When we spoke last week, you had identified two large parcels which are in the northeastern portion of the village that would be potentially available for consideration for groundwater supply. To back up a little bit, obviously in the basin here you have the Walkill River, which is a surface water supply. That surface water supply, just like anywhere else in the Northeast, is actually fed by groundwater discharge. So the flow that you see going through there now is most likely groundwater that naturally comes to the surface. So, I don't know when the last time you folks got some rain. I don't consider that little bit of sprinkle out there an actual storm of any type. So what you're seeing there is groundwater naturally discharging. And a lot of times when you're looking at a groundwater resource, you actually focus in on that to get an idea as how much water may actually be available. My understanding is we're looking for around 260 gallons per minute.
No, I think what we're considering is identifying potential groundwater sources that would yield between 100 and 150 gallons per minute.
Okay, well, we'll shoot high and then we'll be happy with something that's a little lower.
I mean, if you can find 260, that sounds fantastic.
Okay.
But my understanding of how much it would cost to identify and then pay for the engineering to take the water from a groundwater source, I think those economics work if we were to find between 100 and 150.
Okay.
Because our current system is between 620 gallons per minute and 640. That's how much we use across the village, including SUNY and the town water districts.
Okay. Okay, that's actually, given the nature of the hydrogeology in the area, it's probably more in line with what we might anticipate to be able to find. You have two resources here for groundwater, and they are connected. There are these localized pockets of sand and gravel deposited by the glaciers. They tend to be accumulated or concentrated in areas where the underlying bedrock is weaker. That weakness is usually a result of fractures and faults. Those same fractures and faults can also be sources of groundwater in the bedrock. So a lot of times, when we look at sand and gravel, we try to look for sand and gravel that has a pretty extensive reach to it. So there's enough recharge, sometimes hydraulic connection to a surface water body and so forth. The bedrock, on the other hand, can take advantage of that sand and gravel where it's overlain as a source of some recharge, as well as the extension of fractures in the bedrock. Unfortunately, in New Paltz, your bedrock is one type. It's the Normanskill, which is that blackish, grayish shale and sandstone. And generally speaking, the yield or the groundwater supply potential is going to be pretty much focused in on those fractures. So when you're looking at putting in wells and looking for the type of yield that you're looking at, you're going to want to be concentrating on that. And you're going to hope to be able to get that, obviously optimistically from one well. In some instances, it may be more than one well. When you look at the bedrock and it's reflected in the topography of the area, you'll see that there are a lot of ridges that go north-south. There's also other ridges that go northeast-southwest. And those ridges are actually reflecting structure in the bedrock, and that structure being these faults and these fracture systems. So we typically use a method called fracture trace analysis, which helps us identify where those occur. We map them out, and then usually we prioritize locations based on the number of fractures and intersections and so forth. So looking at the parcels that that at least have been identified to us or brought to our attention in that area there, that's what you would actually be looking at. In some instances, you may not find the fractures directly on the property, but you may find them on adjoining properties, and they may be part of a large enough system that you can actually extend them between two areas, and the line that goes in between, you can pretty much assume is also going to occur you know, within another area. And I bring that up because there actually is a significant sand and gravel deposit on that property, so that may actually mask those fractures that occur, though I suspect that the reason why the sand and gravel is there is because there are fractures underneath it. So,
wait,
you know,
I didn't quite understand that. So sand and gravel,
you have a
mask fracture? So
yeah, they fill it in.
It would be harder to identify the
fractures? They would fill it in. So in other words, you wouldn't see a fracture system based on a tonal, which is what you look for in the soil. So a lot of times if the overburden is thick, you may not see the fracture trace, but the configuration, the orientation of that sand and gravel may actually follow the fracture trace. So we use it as kind of a secondary indication. And you have a pretty decent size body of such sand and gravel on that parcel that you pointed out to us for consideration. So typically the approach is when you're looking to supply development, you try to identify what the potential aquifers are. Given the parcels that we're discussing, most likely it's going to be the bedrock. You would normally then follow up with some sort of a fracture trace analysis, which kind of helps you to prioritize where you might put one or more wells to develop groundwater from that resource, and prioritize it based on intersections and so forth. Of course, all of this is theoretical, and I shouldn't say theoretical, but it's all conceptual until you actually drill a well and you find out really what's there. The well is kind of like, you know, the proof in the pudding, as they say. So usually you map out locations, you come in, you do a test well program. A test well program isn't like it used to be. The reason why people used to call something a test well program, is, at least with respect to bedrock, was because it was inexpensive. You could put small diameter wells in. The technology for drilling is such that now the cost of the test well is pretty much the same as the permanent well, so there's no savings, is where I'm going. So what you normally would do is put in a 6-inch diameter well, which could be a test well, but you could put a large enough pump in there that you could get upwards of 100 gallons per minute out of it. So this test well could actually wind up being the actual well that you could in the future use.
Constructed to meet drinking water standards.
Right. So in what Karen's saying, you would have the minimum amount of casing that would be anchored in the bedrock. You'd have a grout border around that casing that would go the entire length, that's provide any kind of surface contamination from getting in. And then you would put a pump in the well and you would actually test it. If the well proved out, you know, you would either, if you were fortunate enough to get what you need out of one, then you would probably want to consider a backup well. So I think in a minimum, you're always looking at two wells. But if it didn't have enough yield, then what you may want to do is put it in another well and look at the cumulative yield between the wells. And the cumulative yield is based on testing that involves measurements at all the wells you put in. It gives you an idea. You don't want to be basically robbing from Peter to pay Paul. You want to be looking for new water, is what it comes down to.
How do you identify that you're not robbing from Peter to pay Paul?
Well, when you're doing these tests, what you're going to be doing is you'll pump one well. And besides looking at the yield, how much water is actually being produced, you're also measuring water levels in the well. So you have another well, you're doing the same thing, and you're looking for what's called interference. If I draw down from this well, besides that water level decline that's associated with pumping from that well, am I seeing a decline over there? And how much, if there is, how much of a decline? So that's how you determine if you're robbing from Peter to pay Paul.
So it's like during the assessment of the recharge?
Correct. Well, there's two things. That's the interference part. The recharge part, really, it's a twofold step. That's part. The other part is the recovery. How quickly does the water level come back up? You don't want to be mining the water. And so that rate of recovery is what comes into determination as to the adequacy of the recharge. I'm sorry, did you want to ask?
So I can fully follow this. One of the two sites in the northeast of the village that we use as examples that we're talking about?
Well, I definitely identified the the area on the Millbrook as a potential, but I think what we're trying to do with Frank and his firm is just to understand the process of how you work with a hydrogeologist and, you know, what's involved in testing an area. So
I just want to be able to fully follow the conversation.
Okay. So that being the case, so here's what we do. We're not well drillers. What we do is we do the fracture trace analysis. So what we do is we identify the potential sites for the wells. Part of that prioritization may include using published information to get a general sense as to what the yield potential could be and the potential for the recharge. We usually assist with putting together a bid for the driller, depending on what you want to do. If you have a driller you want to work with, and you know there's not a need to have an RFP out to respond to a bid for the driller, we'll just put out a technical document, work with the driller that you've selected. If you need to select it based on cost, then with that bid doc, that document, the technical document could be converted to a bid document, and we help with the assistance in terms of selecting and answering questions. Once the driller is selected, we actually have a hydrogeologist will periodically check in on the adequacy of the drilling and how we're pursuing, how we're doing on that.
Basically, I was just pointing out, he mentioned the sand and gravel on the property also, and that as being a possible supply. When we're drilling, going through with the bedrock, the other thing would be to look at and just kind of look at all the, basically the entire depth down to the bedrock. And at the same time, we can identify then if you might have a better source on the shallow sand and gravel type deposits instead of the bedrock might be a good yield. If there are materials that would be more adequate to develop a well in there, we could identify that at the same time for the same boring.
Right. A lot of times with the type of drilling technology that's picked, a lot of times they'll just blow right through the overburden. And the overburden is the, we'll call, lack of better, the soil, the thick natural occurring material above the bedrock. And with the drilling, with having a hydrogeologist out there, the hydrogeologist is able to take a look at the material that's coming up and actually come up with an idea as to whether or not that's worth pursuing in the future. Most likely, because of the nature of this site, it's probably going to focus on the bedrock. But if there is a significant thickness, you know, of sand and gravel being on the order of, say, 15 feet or greater, that you could actually, it's saturated, that you could put a screen in, and it's very coarse, it may be worth considering looking at a sand and gravel well versus a bedrock well. The difference being is the sand and gravel well actually uses a casing to prevent the overburden from collapsing into the hole, but at the point where the water enters from the aquifer, they use a screen. Okay, so it's basically a casing or with a bunch of vertical stays that has a wire that goes around it, and it allows the groundwater to actually enter relatively easy, but it prevents the aquifer material from collapsing into the hole. So that's how it stays open. In the case of a bedrock well, what happens is the casing goes all the way down into the bedrock. It's seated, and in the hole, that the portion of the well that allows the groundwater to come in is just an open hole, just like a drill in a block of wood. It's an open hole in the bedrock, and the water comes in via fractures.
So is the difference that the sand and gravel well is able to collect some water horizontally as well as down at the bottom? Is that the way to understand it?
The water comes through the sand and gravel. And normally it enters horizontally, but it extends to some distance out into the formation. That's where the water comes from. It's not right just from that location. You form what's called a cone of depression. And the radius of influence identifies, looking at land surface, how far out into the aquifer you influence where the groundwater is coming from. So there's a horizontal component and there's a vertical component. It's three-dimensional, for lack of a better, it's probably, just think of the groundwater moves three-dimensional.
Whereas the bedrock well is merely taking water from the bottom of the casing.
It's taking water from that whole open section, just like, again, I'm drilling a hole in a block of wood.
Yeah.
Think about, you know, when I'm drilling a hole through a block of wood, I've got the grain, I may have like an area where maybe I hit a particular layer in the rock, wherever those fractures are, I penetrate, that's where the water comes in. Is it horizontal? Roughly speaking, it's horizontal, but they're interconnected. So there's some further out, there may be some water that vertically comes down, goes into my horizontal fracture, and makes its way to the well.
So I guess I just don't understand the distinction you're making between the equipment for a sand and gravel well versus the equipment for a bedrock well.
I wish I can, I guess I can't draw, right?
You can draw, sure.
Well, I don't know if I can be on the camera.
You can take the...
You can do everything, but you can do some...
Yeah, like, well, you take
it. You can move it closer to you, too.
Great, thank you. Okay, so this is, I'm gonna actually do everything in one. So this is my we'll assume this is kind of conceptually what you actually have over at that property. So what you have is you have sand and gravel that overlays some kind of depression in the rock. And we're going to make the assumption that depression is because there's these fractures and faults. So here's the sand and gravel, here's the surrounding rock, okay? And so the two wells that you could have are one like this. This is a screened well. So you have a casing, okay, and this is the screen. So what happens is, and I'm going to use this to identify where the groundwater surface is when there's no pumping taking place. So what happens, I have a pump in here, and when I pump, I draw the water level down, okay? That's my cone of depression. So all my water comes in like this, but it's coming from, hopefully, primarily from the sand and gravel, all right? Whereas the other type of well, okay, and I have the pump down here, and my water comes in via these fractures. Okay, it's an open hole in the rock. That's all it is. So I have a casing, steel pipe, and I have a hole that goes into the rock. Here I have a casing, the steel pipe, but at the end of the steel pipe is this stainless steel screen that allows, it prevents the aquifer from collapsing, but it allows the water to come into the well. The casings in both cases prevent the aquifer, the loose material from coming in. So, and then usually each one will have some kind of a grout seal, basically cement, so it prevents any surface runoff coming in and contaminating the well. Does that help? Okay.
So our sand and gravel wells are generally not as deep?
It depends on where you are.
In this example.
In this example. But we...
For this to work, the bedrock well has to be deeper.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's got to be, and that's at this particular location. there could be another location where we don't have this.
Yeah.
Maybe we've just got some very thin soil and you're just going right into the bedrock. So that's this part of the world here, you know, in the glaciated region that we have here in the Catskills and upstate New York. Other areas, yes, it can be a lot deeper. Karen and I are working on a project right now in sand and gravel. The wells are 1,400 feet deep. That's sand and gravel. So that just depends on where you are. Okay. Does that help?
Yeah, that helps me understand the difference between
all right.
the two.
The costs usually are a lot different. The cost here is going to be mostly contingent upon the depth you have to go to. The cost here is going to be a lot of times not just the depth, but also how much of this screen. These are usually stainless steel. It's probably the most expensive component of the well, forgetting about the pumps.
So can you give us like a sense of like successful groundwater investigations that you've done recently in this area generally?
Well, I'll focus right here. The work that we did for the city, actually with Hazen and Sawyer on behalf of the city, which was on town property, but I believe it's for you folks, was on the other side of the Wallkill, except for the treatment plant. And the problem over there was that we were told to concentrate strictly on sand and gravel. We never looked at the rock. So with that, we found like one or two locations, but they're all shallow. It's a very thin formation, and in fact, the type of well that would be used is neither of these to develop water from that system. It's actually a horizontal well because the aquifer is so thin, you can't get enough screen in there to effectively pull the water out. So let me continue on then. If I go in terms of rock wells, we have plenty of them down in Orange County. Trying to think up here, I think we've done some work up in Saugerties, also in the rock. Again, it's always this Normanskill formation or the Austin Glen formation, where basically you're looking for these fracture traces, you're trying to get the well to come down to here. New Windsor, town of Newburgh, we do a lot of work in Rockland County. We do a lot of work on the other side of the river also. That's the different type of rock over there and the crystalline rock.
Excuse me. I'm sorry. Have you worked on recent projects in New Windsor where they had to find water?
Yes. In fact, we've got about 6,000 gallons per minute.
Yeah.
And is it a combination of bedrock and sand and gravel?
No, those are all sand and gravel. They actually looked at rock, and there were a couple rock wells, but they were only yielding, and it's the nature of the aquifer. It has nothing to do with where they're sited, like 100 gallons per minute. That doesn't get them where they need to be. Yeah, okay. We put those down. We actually did two things. We evaluated their existing wells to maximize the yield of those and evaluate the performance and see if there were ways to enhance that. Once that was pretty much played out, then at that point, we looked underneath the Hudson River, and actually we drilled angle wells off of Plum Point. And there's an aquifer under about 150 feet of clay under the Hudson. And so to get at it, you had to go at an angle. We did find the water there, but the cost for bringing the power in were pretty restrictive. It's like $100,000 to get the power down to the point. So from that point area, we went over to the Moodna, and we have three supply wells. One does about 1,200 gallons a minute, and they're all in this, the sand and gravel. And the other one does about 1,800 gallons a minute, and the other one does 1,600 gallons per minute.
So in this general area, let's say we had a parcel that was like a 10-acre parcel, and we had access to that parcel, what's the likelihood that you'd find a combination of a few wells and you could get 100 to 150 GPM?
It depends on the parcel. It depends on the geology. No, but what I mean by that is it depends on where it's located based on the geology. So in other words, is the bedrock, do I have these fracture traces? Do I have enough of them on there? Otherwise,
well,
you don't...
I guess what, if you're, if you've identified a parcel and you think it has a reasonable chance of finding water, but what I'm trying to get at is plenty of times you think there's a reasonable chance, but then you go and look and it doesn't have the yield or it doesn't have the quality. So what I'm trying to understand is just like loose probabilities, like best guess, you think it's a reasonable spot to look, but then you spend the money and, you know, what are the chances that you find what you want to find?
With this particular aquifer here, pretty much average, if you had no information, you were just drilling blind, you're probably looking 20, 30 gallons a minute. It's the sediment, it's the nature of the sedimentary rock. If you have information that suggests there are fracture traces, now your probability goes up, but it's a probability. It's no guarantees. But drilling with that information at locations that are biased towards intercepting the fractures is a lot better than just drilling blind. So, you know, I think part of it has to do with, too, the more information you have going into it, whether it be the rock mapping, what you have as far as fracture traces. There's nothing wrong with looking at existing wells. And sometimes the existing wells can identify or help you identify where to go. Maybe you find a pattern that, you know, in this direction, the yield is slightly creeping up. Maybe what you find out is looking at the logs, which is the record of the geologic materials that were penetrated when the well was drilled. You find indications of fractures and so forth.
When you say existing wells, you're talking about like neighboring properties and DEC records?
Yes. Where you talk to, like, we do a lot of work with Jim Weil, and I think he does work up here too. He may have stuff in his files that you can rely upon, you can share, and they can look at that. Keep in mind, a lot of times the other wells may have been drilled for individual well owners. They don't need 150 gallons per minute. They need 3 GPM.
Right.
In fact, they can get away with 1 gallon a minute if you make the well 400, 500 feet deep. You just put a reserve in the ground. So a lot of times it really depends on what the intent is for the well. And that may affect the nature of the record you get.
As far as increasing the probability, though, the one thing, too, is that's why you would start with something like a fracture trace analysis, where you order aerial photos, you take a look at it, and you can assess, does it look favorable or not, before you're mobilizing any equipment and spending the money on drilling. So, you know, you kind of eliminate, and if you'd say, you know, you really don't have a better than average chance of anything beyond a homeowner based on what we can see, then you kind of know that risk versus we see a bunch coming together, the chances of a lot more water moving in that area, and then you can use that to plan your next step.
Yeah, consider these as kind of like, here's your main, and like these are your services to houses and so forth. You always want to hit the main. That's where the most water is going to be flowing through. Now, the other thing about that is, and there's a trade-off here. If you have a lot of sand and gravel over one of these fracture traces, unfortunately, you can't use a tool like geophysics. However, if you don't have that and you have the fracture traces, you can use geophysical techniques to help really focus in on where the fracture traces are. So, and again, the sedimentary rocks aren't as conducive to that technology. The crystalline rocks, like the granites and the gneisses and the metamorphic rocks, like you see up in the Adirondacks, or you may see in the Highlands region further south of here, are more conducive. So there are some other tools you can do to kind of help with that, with the right conditions.
In terms of test drilling, what does that entail in terms of equipment, time?
Well, what would happen is that typically the driller is going to, you're going to give them a location. And the technique that's usually used for Rockwell is called, it's air rotary. So what happens is that he's drilling a hole through this overburden. And basically the drilling apparatus, besides the rig part, that's actually the tool itself, is pulverizing the material. And as it's pulverizing, it's using air to blow it back up to the top. That's how we identify what he's drilling in. We look at what comes back up at the top. Now, this actually can be a nuisance for them, the more overburden that it is, if they're set up for looking at rock, because they got to worry about this stuff collapsing in. So they'll try to blow through it real quick, get the casing in there to prevent any collapse, and then once they set on the rock, they'll continue doing that process, but they can usually go at a slower rate. They don't need quite as much air. What happens up at the top is, besides looking at the material that comes up, you're looking at also to see if they have any back pressure. In other words, if they hit one of these fracture systems, there's a lot of water in there potentially. And all of a sudden, the rig will start to, the instrumentation that's on the drill rig will reflect that. You'll see back pressure. They're having a hard time getting through, and it's not the rock, it's because of all the water that's coming in. Because to bang, you know, and to crush that rock, they need to get the water out of the way. If water keeps coming in, it acts as a cushion. So they've got to increase how much they're taking out of the hole. So that's a good piece of information. And they can usually, what they can do is they can stop the drilling aspect, they can pull that tool up a little bit, and just use the air to pump the water out of the hole. They'll set up a little moat, and what they do is they can use a stopwatch and a bucket and get an estimate as to how much water's coming out of the hole based on what they're lifting, and that gives them an idea. So that's what's involved with the test well drilling. They get to a point, you're done. Usually it's based on, we don't recommend in this part of the world going much deeper than about 300 feet. You're wasting your time, you're wasting your money, because the nature of the fractures is such that the deeper you go, the weight of the overlying rock closes the fractures up. Unless it's something that's at a high angle, and usually you don't see it that much in these sedimentary rock units. Out west, it's a different story, but that's the nature of here. Now, you may go deeper if you're picking up water. You know, if you're continuing to pick up water at 300 feet, it may be worthwhile to continue, because obviously you want to maximize what you get out of each well. So they get done, now the hole is done, and then what you would do is you could test it. And then the testing requires putting in a temporary submersible pump, and the pump actually, they can regulate the flow, you measure the water levels in response in the well to pumping it out, and that gives you an idea of the actual, not just, it gives you what's called the specific capacity, which is really what's important in the well, not just, yeah, I pumped 30 gallons a minute out of the well. Well, for how long, and what was the water level? And you're looking, and then that, there's information that comes that you actually graph.
The question is not directed at you or any individual hydrologist, but at hydrology. So you say that once you select the sites, it's pretty much until you drill the test wells, you don't really know what you're going to find. And same thing would probably be true about recharge rates and those sorts of things. Is it just professional gambling that, yeah, I guess, how much, when it comes to predicting recharge rates and that sort of thing, that's just as one example, how much can you predict and control that, and how much is just the luck of the draw?
That's based on science. That's why you run the pumping test. And the pumping test provides you with a way by tracking the trends in the groundwater level, which reflect what's going on in the aquifer, whether they stabilize, whether they don't stabilize. If they stabilize, that's the recharge rate. If you have two wells or more wells, and you actually are able to start tracking out how far out into the aquifer you're influencing the groundwater levels, that's part of the, goes into calculations for figuring out the quantification. Because it gives you an idea of how far in the aquifer are, you know what the radius of influence is, you know what that area is, you know how much rainfall there is over the course of the year, you know what the response, and then you can actually quantify what the recharge is. So that part, there's no gambling. And I, you know, as far as the fracture trace goes, with this type of aquifer, that's what you have. So until you drill, you can't tell. But from that point on, quantification of the yield, the quantification of the recharge, that's all science. There's no guesswork there. There's projections, there will be ranges. You know, unlike engineering, it's not an exact number. okay, because it's Mother Nature. So we have to take certain types of assumptions that go into those calculations, but that's how you do it.
The other thing, too, is that this area is not, like, so remote that people don't have information. There have been a lot of different wells drilled and studies, and, you know, basically our companies and county and state and stuff, where they've actually done these types of tests and they've assigned values to the different bedrocks. So kind of going into it, you would know, at least be able to take an area with a recharge rate and have an estimate going in, would it likely sustain your demand? So that would be a part of it too, before you even do start the exploration, was that those numbers could be looked at also.
Is that why when you were previously looking in New Paltz, you at that location, you were instructed to not go into the rock?
I don't know, that really wasn't part of, DEP was paying for that, and we were a sub to Hazen and Sawyer, and we were asked just to look at sand and gravel. That's
and using a certain methodology. Yeah. That was the other thing too, is that basically we had to use a geoprobe technology was what their preference was, and that limited the depth at which we could go down, so we didn't even really get close to the bedrock. Whereas we were trying, you know, to convince them that a drive and wash type method where you can get better information maybe more quickly and deeper might be a better way to go. But because it was preliminary, they wanted to stick with the other method. So that kind of restricted a little bit where we could go as far
it's
as that goes.
It's kind of like drilling through the ground with this versus this.
Well, tell me if I'm right or wrong. I thought that the reason that the DEP was focused on sand and gravel is if you get lucky and find a good yielding sand and gravel, it can be a real mother load of a yield. Whereas a bedrock well, even when you find a great yield, you're never going to find that mother load of a well. It might be a great producer, but if you want to hit a grand slam, you got to look for the sand and gravel.
Well, actually, that's part of it. The other part is the sand and gravel. If you notice where we were down at the fairgrounds, and then we were across the bridge over here. We were by the wall kill. So in each instance, it was looking for sand and gravel that potentially could be hydraulically connected to the wall kill, so that would contribute to the recharge. You'd have the natural filtration of the sand and gravel, but there's a lot of conditions there too that have to be right, that some of that water would actually be moving from the wall kill to basically replace what you were pumping out. That was it. There are some areas where the bedrock can be a grand slam too. I'm not saying yes or no here. I'm just saying that it was the sand and gravel, and it was the proximity to the wall kill as a source of recharge. Okay.
But you actually pushed back because you felt that there was more potential at that location.
I'm sorry.
You had recommended a different type of exploration because you felt there might be more potential by
looking
at the rock?
Well, our concern was that using this versus this, that if I encounter something the size of this, which one's going through it? Okay, so that was a concern. They wanted to go this way, the DEP did, because they felt this was quicker and so forth. When we do exploration work, and we're unfettered and we're allowed to pick the technique we go for a technique that's appropriate for the type of aquifer that we're looking at, so we're not restricted by the drilling technique. With that said, you know, in all these instances we did get some decent depth, but the nature of the material that was encountered, even what we did come through, except for the one area where we identified the possibility of putting in an infiltration gallery, which is the horizontal one that I was talking about, didn't look that good.
I'm just trying to imagine the equipment that will actually be going into that area. How big is it?
Okay, sure. Now, one of the things is that, you know, there's site prep. And the site prep, the driller doesn't care how you get in there. You can go direct. If you need to take advantage of what's going on land use wide, you know, it's just a matter of having the road put in. I will tell you that once the driller goes in there with a rig, at least the type of rigs we'd be talking about here, the road's going to be there, that path's going to be there for a long time. If you want to maintain it, it'll be there as long as you want to maintain it. It's probably the size of, it's bigger, it's about the length of, a little smaller than a tractor trailer, but wider. It's going to have a crane on it, a mast. Mast is going to be about 20 feet high, because the drill rods are 20 feet long. Mm-hmm. It's got a diesel engine. Now that's for doing rock. If we were looking at sand and gravel specifically, the rig probably would be smaller. It would be a cable tool rig, or, and like Karen was mentioning earlier, a drive and wash rig. It's the size of, if you go skiing, you ever see those little cats, those bombardiers that the guys drive up and down? Mm-hmm. Well, they actually use a rig like that that's fitted with a little tool.
What was that called again?
A bombardier.
Bombardier.
Right. Then that allows, but that's going to be small diameters, mm-hmm. like 2.5 inch, but it's called drive and wash. It's a pretty good technique for sand and gravel. So it really depends on the nature of the aquifer, but that's basically, it's not going to be like any of these like gas rigs that you see, you know, further out, you know, out west, or the types of rigs that we use when we're drilling 1,300 feet deep and so forth. You got the noise.
You also have a second rig that's the support rig on it, just to, so you'd have another rig that would hold like the 20-foot rods and stuff. So just, yeah. It would be two vehicles. And, you know, possibly like a pickup truck if the guy's there, if you're trying to come up with a vision of it.
Okay.
Yeah, these, the rock wells, given the type of rock that you have here, probably assuming no complications, and what I mean by a complication is they get down here and maybe they've got a really significant fracture zone that keeps collapsing. I mean, that's a good problem to have, but the driller doesn't like it. So that could take time. But otherwise, to go down 300 feet, you're probably talking 3 days max. That includes putting the casing in, grouting it, waiting overnight, and then continuing on down through the rock.
So let's pretend that we had five properties that we wanted you to take a look at. Is the first step you do the fracture trace analysis and you say, well, maybe take a look at this property, definitely don't take a look at this property. Like if you had five, What's the likelihood that you have a mix of, you know, some you want to explore further, some are probably not?
With five properties, assuming that they're not all right next to each other.
No, not all.
Exactly.
Let's pretend. Five 10-acre parcels.
Right. I would think, yeah, I mean, within that type of load of properties, I would tend to think that, yeah, you would definitely have at least some that would have higher fracture traces. What we would also do is we would look at geologic maps, sand and gravel maps. We'd look at the DEC well records for depths, like depths to casing tells us how much overburden recharge potential you have versus the bedrock. All of that would get factored in. Generally, we would pick from those locations then where fracture trace might be better based on just the regional structures you can see in the mapping. Select those, discuss it with you, then we would order the photos and then do the fracture trace. And then all of those pieces get combined and prioritized based on, sometimes it's just on our end as far as yield, sometimes it's more how does it connect to your system. We also look at any DEC like spill sites or contamination sites. Is there anything close by that, you know, wow, you have three fractures right here, but you have a gas station, a dry cleaner, and something else. Chances are you might need some kind of treatment. Do you want to go that route? And all of that's part of a work together effort of this is our part. This might yield more water. Can't guarantee the quality. Do we want to move on to the next one? It's so remote from your system, you're going to have to run a whole bunch of transmission main to get in there. All of that, you know, we factor all that in working with and, you know, discussing as far as that goes, helps.
If I can, just to kind of to go through that point one more time.
Here, just grab one light.
So let's assume that, you know, this is,
oh, I'm sorry.
Really do have an audience at home, believe it or not.
let's assume that this is the town. As an example, and you have a parcel here, we've got one down here, and let's just say one over here. And as Karen said, the first thing we normally do is look at the hydrogeology. And as an example, there's mapped here some sort of a sand and gravel deposit. Maybe over here is the river, and there's a deposit that goes like this. So we know we have that. And then for argument's sake, we take a look at the air photos, and we find this parcel here has a fracture trace. This one has one that goes like this. We see a small one like here. There's one that goes here, there's one that goes here, and one that goes here. Pick another one over here. So what we may do is say, you know what, looking at this, we always look for the intersections. That's the first level of priority. Then what we also look at is, do we have sand and gravel that can be a supplemental source of recharge? So what we may decide is, this is number one, as an example. This is number two. But then all of a sudden, we do some research on DEC and find out that, you know, there's contamination here, and this fracture trace goes right towards it. Well, this all of a sudden dropped down to number four, okay? Whereas initially it was going to be number two. This one here has a fracture trace. We notice that it does intercept over towards the river. You know, we'll use that as a criteria, so this becomes number two. And this becomes number three. So that's part of that goes. Then you come back to us and you say, you know what? I don't have any way of connecting over here. I'm going to have to run 200 feet of pipe. But over here, I've got a main that's right outside the property. That goes into it. But that's really relying on you folks. That's not us. So the hydrogeology end is going to look at, you know, what's there, potential. And it's going to look at, you know, what the potential threats are. And then we prioritize it. Then we come back to you. And then you folks take it from there.
It almost seems like what you're saying is, if you had just a random group of properties, maybe a quarter of them would be worth exploring.
Quarter to half,
yeah, I would say. Is, you know, the more you have, the better off. Typically, an approach that you normally do, like we did for Newburgh, we looked at the entire town. So we weren't hamstrung by, you know, parcels already being identified. Now, I'm not saying that's not what you do, because bottom line is, when you get done, now maybe part of the prioritization process, oh, we have a parcel near there, or that is a parcel of ours, whatever. But, you know, if it's a parcel that looks really good and you don't own it, now you're faced with, you're going to do something else to try to get that, and maybe you don't want to do that. So, obviously, the larger the area, the more potential sites you're going to identify, the smaller area, the less. If you have parcels and that's the way you're going, the more you have, the better off we are. And the larger the parcels, the better off we are.
Because of setbacks.
Right. That's another thing to keep in mind, too. Yeah. You have setbacks. You know.
Yeah, the Department of Health's going to require probably like a 200-foot ownership or control around the wellhead. So that's the other thing, too, with number two, the way he drew it there is the fracture's right on the edge of the property. Well, then maybe you don't have the control near the wellhead. That's all factored in also, you know, wet, the other thing
like
is wetlands.
It's the 25% of a random group of properties might be worth exploring.
I've seen higher, but that's fine. If you go into it that way, then you won't be disappointed.
Okay. Anybody else have questions?
What about the noise level that comes from the exploration process?
It depends on the type of drilling rig. So in the case of rock, you're going to hear a compressor. It's going to be, you know, and you're going to hear the actual drilling. So you've got the compressor as kind of a background noise. When it's actually drilling, once it hits the rock, it's a chatter. There's a reason why everybody wears earplugs. But there's a lot that's done with respect to noise baffles and stuff that can be put up. Obviously, the more in the woods you are, the better off you are. In the case of sand and gravel, that's pretty low noise. It's usually the rock wells that are the noisier. You know, you have them drill between 8 and 5. You know, you limit when you want them to drill.
And then how long does it take? Like days or weeks?
Well, that's what I was saying to you earlier. In the case of the rock well, the casing will pretty much take you a day. And the reason for that is he's got to drill through the overburden. Now, even if it's 5 feet, He still has to drill through the overburden. He has to get what's called a rock socket. So he's got to drill kind of like a countersink hole in the rock, set the casing, and then he's got to grout that in place. And the grout needs to cure. Usually overnight is more than enough. The state has requirements as the minimum. Usually it's like 8 hours. So once that, he'll come back the next day, and then boom. 300-foot well, assuming no complications from any kind of fall in or collapse, 2 days once the casing is done. So it, because of the nature of the rock, it's not a, a big deal. The sand, these types of wells here can take 5, 6, 7 days because there's a whole process to getting that screen set, doing a gravel pack, the whole nine yards. A lot of times what will happen in this case is you'll do the exploration, you'll do the casing and leave it there. You've got to figure out, looking at the material, what size screen to put in and so forth. You may not come back for 2 weeks.
But so it's continuous noise.
Correct.
So it's up to a week or two to set up a well, and then you still have to test it.
Yeah, and that's generally, you'd have a portable generator. So, and for 100 to 150 gallon per minute well, you're not going to be running a large pump. It wouldn't be a large generator in general. It would run for the entirety of like a 72-hour period. Again, there are ways to reduce noise, and if you're putting together like a bid spec or getting costs, what you would do is you would include that type of language. Like we do very detailed specifications for drilling and testing, and following certainly town or village noise ordinances. And if it is too close to residential or other properties, commercial properties, they can set up different types of sound barriers, sound blankets and stuff to dampen that noise chain. You know, maybe do the more expensive generator, build that into their cost, but it's going to keep neighbors happier.
The generators for the pumping test are usually pretty much come, they're pretty quiet. So it's really just the drilling aspect that'll probably be your noisy part, because that's the compressor that's usually on the rig. You know, unless it was a big well and a lot of water and they had to bring in a supplemental compressor. And so then on top of that, you just have that chattering once they get into the rock. And it's like a jackhammer, but it's a muted jackhammer. It's the best way I can describe it.
Any other questions before we move on to the next item? Okay, thank you very much for explaining things to us.
Okay. Nice.
Ooh. So I just wanted to share with the board that I reached out to the DEC, and I shared with them the same information that I've shared with the board previously about the area along the western edge of the Millbrook Preserve, and I asked them to comment on whether there are sensitive areas in terms of environmental sensitivities or wetlands, and the gentleman I spoke with up in Albany was very, very willing to do some research and report back to us. I haven't heard back yet. I sent him a reminder note today. He also said that he would touch base with the Region 3 folks about that particular area. So I thought that would be kind of useful information for us to have.
How would that gel with the...
Don, grab the mic.
Yeah. So I understand the Wokehill Valley Land Trust has already identified environmentally sensitive areas in the Millbrook Preserve. How does this interact with that? Is this an independent question? Is this I don't understand why this request was made. I just don't understand it.
Yeah, I thought it would be useful to get information directly from the state agency that specializes in state identifying home. these environmental issues or sensitivities. So, just sharing with the board that they were very willing to try to help us understand what's there and report back to us. So once we get that, I'll share that with everyone. And then I had commented at the last meeting about the idea that up at Mohonk there's obviously a hotel, that at capacity has 600 individuals, so they use a fair amount of water. And I went up and visited their engineer responsible for their water system. And I went with John Lowler. I thought it would be useful for John to understand what was there as well. And it's really interesting that they use three different sources for water. They use the lake during the month of February because that's when turbidity is lowest, and they get 100% of their water from the lake only during the month of February generally. They would source water from the lake more often if they could, but turbidity from surface water is a big problem because it's much more expensive to treat and it gums up their filtration plant. So they also have two spring boxes about 2 miles down the hill west of the mountain house along Mossy Brook Road, and they get a small amount of water from those spring boxes, more in the spring than the rest of the year. And those spring boxes have been there since 1926. So the vast majority of the water that is used at the mountain house is from two groundwater wells, two bedrock wells, about 300 feet deep each. One of them is permitted for 50 GPM, the other is permitted for 90 GPM. The engineer believes that they could both yield 90 GPM, and that is what they use for, you know, most of the time. And those two groundwater wells are also in the forest down near the spring boxes, about 2 miles down the hill from the mountain house. And then they're pumped up in the, through a 6-inch water main up to the mountain house. They also anticipate within the next 5 years probably drilling for another well, probably in the nearby area, to source additional groundwater. And then what's interesting is how much water they actually use. In the month of August, they reported to the Department of Health that they use 132,000 gallons per day. So that works out to 4 million gallons per month this past August. Obviously, July and August are their peak times. And then I looked back historically, what does the village plant, including our four ponds, as well as the water that we buy from the DEP, and we use on average each summer month about 22 million gallons. So 4 million gallons at Mohonk versus 22 million gallons. They're using about 18% of the water that we use, and they're sourcing it from two groundwater wells in the woods. So I just thought that was just interesting research as far as, you know, what a neighbor who has 8,000 acres of preserved property does as far as sourcing water. Moving on to any questions about that? Mm-hmm. Moving on to the DEP backup water supply project. So I shared with you a report that was drafted by Peter Mayer of Demand Management, and it's a report where we're looking to make a formal request to the DEP asking for financial assistance of $750,000. We might also consider some sort of cost share arrangement to offer to the DEP. And these funds would be used to pay for updated meters in the town water districts, as well as master meters for the 9 locations where water enters the SUNY campus. But what I think would be really valuable is if we had one centralized metering and billing system that included updated software that our village government, since we are the water authority for this community, put everything under one roof, and you know, really be able to monitor how much water we're using. I'm a huge proponent of understanding what we use to encourage individuals and and larger water users to pursue conservation efforts, and I really feel like a demand management effort would help with conservation. You know, if we could end up using less than the approximately 620 gallons per minute that we use as a community, that's going to save us money. And so what I'm looking for is just authorization from the board to formally submit this request for $750,000 to the DEP.
I have a question. If we identify another location that we would like to try and source water from for our backup water, and we would like the DEP to help us purchase that property, will this $750,000, is it going to the well too often? Do we want to make sure that we find our backup water supply first before we request $750,000?
Well, unfortunately, we're in a holding pattern while there's litigation pending.
Okay. So then we would be advancing this while we're in a holding pattern?
Yeah, I've been instructed by the DEP that we have a very tight window to make this request, and time is of the essence. If we make this request, we have to make it now. We have to get it in front of the senior DEP officials. That is what has been, that's how I've been advised by others at the DEP. If they're going to consider it, they need to consider it now.
I think it's important to note, Dennis, that the litigation has nothing to do with the water management component of our project. And I, for one, have considered the water management project or component of the project to be important, and even quite important. There's both the conservation and the actual management of the water resources that we actually have or will have. And I believe we should go forward with this request, having making no pretense to knowledge about what will happen in regard to the other components of the project.
Okay.
So I think if we ask them for this money, which was in the original project, but everything got held up because of litigation, I believe we have a very good chance of forwarding the water management component, regardless of what happens in any other component of the project.
Regardless. Okay, thank you, Tom.
I think the concern is, and I hadn't thought about this, the concern is that if we do then find some alternate sources of water, what we were talking about a couple weeks ago, let's identify some potential sources and then go to the DEP and see if they'll pay for it. And unless we do the preliminary work and say, we found something here, DEP, will you pay for it? They're not going to pay for anything. Now, if they've already given us $750,000 for here, and we then subsequently identify alternate sources and we say, DEP, will you pay for it? You're going to tell us to go take a walk.
I don't believe that at all. We had substantially more than that in the original project for all of the components. And I see no reason why, if we are successful in several of the components, why they would deny us access to funds for the others once we're able to go forward with those. We now still can go forward with the reservoir enhancements, and we can still go forward with the water management component. I see not one reason not to go forward with those two components. There's nothing about that is an impediment to our asking for additional monies that were originally in the budget. This was in the budget. Let's get them to fund this component of the project.
Yeah, I actually completely agree. I think if there's an opportunity down the line, this is not going to make, you know, they will take a hard, serious look at a request in the future. That's the sense that I get.
Okay, so this was budgeted along with the money to acquire the Plessa property, so the budget has extra room to acquire property.
Well, this,
based on the initial budget, you know, and well, everything's it, based on requests, but.
Yeah, this dollar amount wasn't budgeted, but there was a category for demand management that would encourage conservation. And I think it's incredibly important for us to use less water. If we could use significantly less water, then there's a lot less pressure for us to keep buying water from the DEP or keep identifying other sources. So this directly helps with that initiative in terms of consumption. I mean, that's the only reason that they would consider it is if it speaks to a conservation effort.
Wait, there's yet one more component of water management, and that is the ability of the village personnel to handle the use of water depending upon rainfall projections. We've been very concerned about what the projections for rainfall in our region are and how to use the water that we actually have. There, in the phase two report, you can see in the design component that there is a plan to be able to move water from the uppermost reservoir to the lowermost reservoir, and to be able that, you know, based upon projections about rainfall. So there are several components in here for water management. I see no reason for not going forward with anything we can do in water management that will, one, save us the use of water, the conservation side, and two, enable us to manage the use of water, the water management side.
Would the DEP put that in writing, that if that this request wouldn't affect any future requests? I know you can't answer that tonight. I'd like to. Yeah.
So do you want to not pass this now in order to wait for something to go up through the DEP chain for us to have a formal?
No, I was assuming you would ask Dan Michaud and he would respond by email. I wasn't thinking of a chain of anything.
Okay.
Well, it's a very simple thing.
Dan Michaud has no authority to make a guarantee like that.
Well, I guess my concern is we have a divergence of views on the board here, and that some people on the board are pushing for alternate sources of water supply, and some prefer drilling in the preserve. I am very, very concerned that when I opened an email that I got at 4:44 this afternoon, including a draft language for the conservation easement, that it did not reflect in any way, shape, or form the board's unanimous vote with regard to drilling in the preserve. So I'm overly cautious, I guess, when it comes to this issue, and I'm concerned, as it has been stated, that if we pass this tonight without any reassurance on that point, that we've pretty much done damage to this community's ability to go after alternate sources of drinking water outside of the preserve. That's my concern.
If we don't pass this tonight, this opportunity will go away.
You'll forgive me. I think you are being overly cautious, as you yourself said. I see no reason to think that passing this motion now will have anything whatsoever to do with possible, probable, potential drilling in the preserve. I don't think it has anything whatsoever to do with that. Anything.
Again, I appreciate that. I appreciate the reassurance. I am still overly concerned.
Well, I'm mildly frustrated. I just sat through an hour and a half of lessons on hydrogeology. I've spent 3 years, and all of you have access to all of this information. So I may be a little testy right now.
Okay.
You have information about the Hazen-Sawyer report. You have information about the design of this entire project. Everything that has been done in this project is available to you. Nothing is hidden from you. There are components of this project that can go forward without affecting other components. Water management and conservation are certainly among those. I have more information than I care to comment on about weather projections and the virtues of water management. But I'll send you, if you care to have that, But I don't want to bother if you're not even going to read the stuff we already have. So I would like us to be able to move forward. I do not want to sit through another hour and a half of lessons on hydrogeology when what we're looking for is expertise, not lessons. And I for one, would hate to see us bypass a $750,000 possibility. We don't have a guarantee, it's a possibility, because of an over-cautious approach to this. So I hope we can pass this now.
Any other comments before I motion that we vote on this?
I have a question which has come up in the past, and it has to do with the switching the billing frequency, which I completely understand how much easier it would be to track leaks, you know, whether it's municipal buildings, whether it's SUNY New Paltz, or individual homes. I completely understand the need to reduce leaks that go on forever, because that's wasted water. My question is to the cost in terms of us being able to meter more frequently, or is that something that's so well built into the system to make it easier to meter?
I had exactly that same concern with Peter Mayer, because I also know that when you bill more often, it just costs more money. Mm-hmm. But we spend an enormous amount of money already billing quarterly, because we have an incredibly inefficient system in the town water districts, and then they report information to us, and then we're sorting it out. Any sort of additional expense of sending out bills monthly will be more than paid for with a much more efficient system. And that's the pushback that I've gotten from Peter Mayer when I asked him or expressed my concern about monthly versus quarterly. You know, as far as he is concerned, this is industry best practice, that if you want to encourage conservation, you have to bill monthly.
Well, I think we're talking about two different issues. I don't think anyone's got any concern about whether the technology or whether the software is a benefit. I guess the concern is with regard to the pot of money that is available to this community from the DEP.
And like Tom, I've spent an enormous amount of time with the DEP talking about this project, trying to understand, you know, where the sensitivities are, where the likelihood of them paying for something or not paying for something. And I feel very strongly that we have an opportunity to make this request. I think they will consider it. There's a chance that they will definitely not award us $750,000, but they will consider it. And I think it's a very important opportunity for us to pursue.
Well, to ease my concerns, if we were to do this, and if we were subsequently to find alternate water supplies outside of the preserve, and the DEP would not pay for the work to be done, would you be comfortable having the village pay for that? That's what I'm looking to avoid. If you'd be comfortable with the village paying for any drilling of any alternate water sources, if the DEP said no to a subsequent request, I don't get the sense that that's something that we would want to do.
I don't understand the question.
The scenario is that we ask the DEP for this $750,000. 3 months from now, we have identified some sources of drilling that are in areas that you don't particularly, based on your previous comments, want to go after.
What properties do I not want to go after?
Or to put it inversely, your strong preference is to maintain the ability to drill in the preserve.
Yes. If we found any property that showed promise and made sense financially, I'm all for looking at the property.
Well, I'm happy to make that clarification, but to continue the example, if in the future we were to identify sources of water that may provide us with a permanent source of water, which could be included in the DEP project or not, and they said, no, we won't pay for that because we've already given you this $750,000 3 months ago, which I think is a reasonable scenario. I appreciate what I've heard tonight, but that seems like a reasonable response. I might respond that way if it were me. You know, I just gave you $750,000. I'm not going to give you more. Then the burden would fall on this village and its taxpayers to finance any other future drinking water supplies. And I just want to make sure that everyone is comfortable with the implications, the potential implications of this vote.
I think that'd be a fantastic problem. If we identified some mythical property that had promising yield and it's been identified as one that we should test for water, and we were to pay for that test, that would be a great problem. I would be all for spending taxpayer money to test, or not, well, ratepayer money, because the money would come from our water fund. I would be all for using the water fund to investigate this hypothetical source.
But it would have nothing to do with this $750,000.
Absolutely nothing, yeah.
Absolutely nothing.
No, but I think in Don's scenario, he's saying, so this mythical source was, or property was identified. We go to the DEP, we say, look, we found this promising parcel. Would you help us test for water there? And they say no. And I think what you're asking me is, would I be supportive of using our water fund to test for water there? Absolutely.
Appreciate the reassurance.
So is there a motion on the table or not?
Yeah, so my motion is
to formally request $750,000.
That I make this request. There's also language in here in the form of a cost-sharing arrangement. So my understanding is the DEP may respond more favorably if we say we're putting X number of dollars towards this, and I'm just pulling this out of nowhere. What if we say we're willing to spend $10,000? I don't know if that's even material in a $750,000 ask, but maybe it shows a little bit of goodwill. Maybe it should be more, maybe it should be less.
Well, I second the motion. We've had some discussion already.
But I'm modifying the motion to include identifying a dollar amount.
Oh, you do have $25,000 in here for village share.
Well, I look, are you talking about going into negotiation with DEP now?
No. What I'm talking about is making a formal request,
yes,
saying we're looking for, because the estimated cost for this project is $750,000. So we're looking for a project that costs $750,000, but we would pay for $25,000 of that $750,000.
And we would take that now from the water?
So I guess budget? We would, I guess basically what we're asking for is $725,000.
It says the total for the different meters.
Oh, I see. It's,
yeah.
Right, so I had that wrong. Sorry. So the total project is $775,000. We are asking for
$750,000.
So the village share would be $25,000.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
And I just have a quick question. Just the plan is still in draft form in terms of what Peter Mayers is working on. The emergency response plan, do you know what that? It looks like there's two areas that are still being worked out. Do you know any, you know? No?
I'm not sure.
Okay. All right.
I mean, this is his draft.
Yeah.
He's not working on it anymore. He's given it to us. Mm-hmm. We can tweak it as we see fit. So,
and so the $25,000 was already in the information we had. I did recall that when I read the packet. But all this comes from Dan Michaud. All the comments are from Dan Michaud. But you don't think Dan Michaud could give us assurance on whether the DEP would consider granting this award negatively in terms of other funds? That's your position. I just restated it.
Yeah, I do not believe that. I think they would say, they would roll their eyes and slam the door in our face.
Do you have a sense of the $750,000? How much of that would we, as a village, need to spend out of our own budget if we were to not get this money from the DEP? For instance, the master meters at SUNY, is that something we'd have to purchase anyway? Right, we can get away with not having new software.
The master meters,
software,
from memory, I believe, cost about $500,000.
Yeah, somewhere between
$450,000 and $500,000. Or maybe it's like $450,000, and then the I think it's there in the.
It's here, yeah. It's $470,000, and then for what, the Badger Orion meters and customer information for the town is $235,000. Billing software for monthly billing is $70,000, so that's where we get the $775,000.
Okay, I could also add that our staff is really supportive of. You know, this kind of scenario where we're doing all the water billing under one roof, it's going to save them a ton of time and effort and aggravation. So, did you second it?
Yes.
Okay, so all in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Aye. I'm kind of abstaining. I feel like I need more information.
Okay, Rebecca?
Aye.
Okay, so four, and then Don abstained.
And, you know, and also with that, it's not like they're going to just like turn around and write out a check tomorrow. So if we do, in the meantime, do come up with alternatives beyond this that are more reasonable, I couldn't imagine them not being willing to hear another scenario.
You're thinking like they might come back to us with a counter? Of some sort?
They might, but also if, yeah. You know.
So let's see. I mean, the plan is submit the request.
Yes.
And then Neil and I were going to go meet with Dan and his bosses and see what they say. So next item, Shade Tree Committee requests that the village retain services for an arborist at a cost not to exceed $3,000. I'm in favor of this, provided that Blue is involved in the selection of the arborist.
So moved.
Any discussion? I could add that I've spoken with Blue about this, and he feels that it actually could be useful to save him time in terms of discussing, you know, what it's almost like a third party opinion on how to deal with particular trees, if there's just an expert opinion to offer that to the Shade Tree Commission. So Rebecca seconded it. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, great news on the new Seagrave pumper truck. I signed the contract today. I shared an email with the board. We our attorneys, I think most valuable skill is reading contracts and identifying things that that other attorneys may overlook. And when Will first identified an issue with the contract regarding the purchase of this pumper truck, the pushback that we got was, well, we don't change the contract. But then when we pushed harder and we spoke with the attorneys at Seagrave, they said, you know what, you actually identified a very fair point, and they were willing to change the contract. And we've had a very positive experience dealing with Seagrave. And this is exactly what the chiefs have said, is that Seagrave is just considered an excellent company that offers a great product and fantastic customer service. So thanks to our attorney for you know, really digging deep and understanding what we were purchasing, because we're buying a village-owned asset that costs nearly $500,000. So the next item, number nine, we received favorable news about the various borrowings. So our village, across water fund, I include the sewer fund and the general fund, but we have borrowings across 11 different projects, and these have existed for many years prior to all of our administrations. And two-thirds of the $4 million in debt that we currently have, we are borrowing at 1.16% via a one-year bond anticipation notes. And the other, I thought, interesting detail about those 11 projects is that two-thirds of the value of that $4 million was in three large projects, one being the 2006 water tank project up at Cherry Hill that also included the replacement meters that all village residents received. And then there was a subsequent borrowing regarding the replacement of the other tank at Cherry Hill. And then the third largest borrowing relates to our acquisition of the Millbrook Preserve that we borrowed for when we purchased that property last year. Next item is a community solar garden project at the former town landfill. I've attended a few different meetings with Rick Alfondre and Supervisor Batez to explore siting a community solar garden at the landfill. It seems like there may be an opportunity to form a public-private partnership with different members who could source electricity from the generation at this type of landfill. I think one interesting thing that we don't want to overlook, though, is as we also, in parallel, consider a microgrid, we wouldn't want to necessarily put critical assets that we would want to have backup resiliency on this type of net metered solar garden, because in an outage, this solar garden would be tied to the national grid, and we would not be receiving power at any property if it was tied to the solar garden. So I think next steps is for an RFP to be developed and then to look for a developer to respond to constructing a solar garden and forming a public-private partnership out at that town-owned landfill. I'm sure we'll discuss that at an upcoming joint meeting. New York Rising support of the New Pulse fire stations and EOC. The contact at New York Rising, I sent her a couple of emails recently and I did not get a response. But then when I spoke with one of her colleagues recently, I was actually not relieved to find out that she was dealing with a situation that made it difficult for her to respond. But that project continues to move forward, where the New York Rising funds should be used to pay for a new fire station. Next item is the proposed public square at Kempner's 45 Main Street property. So I've been discussing with the professors from SUNY who are interested in optimizing the parking lot in front of the post office to improve safety and improve the pedestrian experience along the sidewalk of both North Chestnut and Main Street. I actually was out at the site with Rich Gottlieb, the owner of Rock and Snow, and Craig Shankles recently, and we took the survey and manually measured spots and the concept of this proposed public square. So we're taking a hard look at what might work for that project, and I'm meeting with the SUNY professors tomorrow. Next item is an approval of the clerk's office. They're looking for a request to destroy records. This seems like a perfunctory request, and we're going to investigate whether we can put this on consent orders in the future. So I'd like to move that we accept this request.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Hey, Tim, go back to item 13. Just,
sure.
What sort of spots did you identify for what purpose? I think I missed something. You and Rick.
Rich Gottlieb, Craig Shankle. So, you know, this is an ongoing conversation. We've talked about this before at this board table, but the general idea, and it was originally Floyd Niffin's concept, that there's definitely a safety issue with the parking lot in front of the post office. So could that access between Mobile and the wine store and parking lot project be optimized so you continue to have an adequately wide aisle for cars and trucks to get through between the properties, but just improve the safety and then end up with some sort of more open space along North Chestnut and Main Street to improve the sidewalk experience. So that's the concept that we're wrestling with, and we have some designs, but Rich, Craig, and myself were just on site kind of doing a reality check and measuring and comparing our notes to the property's survey that was done a year or two ago.
Thank you.
So on August 30th, we submitted an application to Senator Bonasek's office for a hydrant and valve replacement. Our request was for just over $81,000. The village would pay for the other just over $40,000. We're hoping to get this project started in the spring of 2017. And, you know, as we've spoken about before, we have approximately 8 hydrants in the community that require adapters to connect to 2.5-inch valves on the fire hydrants. And the convention and the, you know, we have about 130 hydrants throughout the total system. So generally we want to be able to not use an adapter and connect to a 5-inch connector. But also in this project, which totals $122,000, there are about another 4 older hydrants that would need to be replaced. So that's why we have pursued this capital facilities grant through Senator Bonasek's office. We have our fingers crossed that we'll find out about an award. Next item is the adoption of a film policy. Do we have any comments, or are we just going ahead and adopting this policy? Will hasn't, so let's just kick it to the next.
Can I follow up again? So,
okay, yeah. So let's put that on the next agenda. Just wait a moment for Alex to return.
Just say I spoke to Will just before coming over about the Airbnb/short-term rental issues, and there were several other items that he was not able to get to just because of volume at his office.
Oh, you're just plugging that in? Okay, so you got that on the next agenda. We'll hopefully talk with Will and get his counsel on the film policy. And then also, have we heard, so next item 17, discussion review of the Jacob Elting burying ground agreement. So we're waiting for that draft agreement from?
Dina, yeah, nothing yet. I spoke with her on Friday, and they have something, but they haven't sent it to us.
Okay, great. So we hope to hear from them and put that on the next agenda. So item 18 is the Verizon Computel confidentiality agreement. We just need board approval. So Computel is a firm that does audits. They're looking at our Verizon bill. So all we're doing is signing an NDA that allows them to look at our Verizon bills. I'd like to make a motion that.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Next item, this is re-upping our agreement with Capital Markets Advisors. They're the folks who help us with bonding. So we're just looking to re-up that agreement. I'd like to motion that we do so. All in favor?
Aye.
Next item, Environmental Policy Board and its subcommittee quorum discussion. I don't have anything on that. What is that?
I think the item may have come from two of the members of the board, one commutes to New York City. His bus gets in to New Paltz when it's on time, 10 minutes before the meeting. Been a couple meetings he hasn't been able to make. And if that happens, and the other member of the committee who works beginning at 10 p.m. sleeps through the meeting, then we don't have a quorum. With the addition of Mr. Murphy this evening, I think we should avoid that issue for the future. So shouldn't be a problem.
I'm wondering if we should consider alternates as well.
Yeah, I'm wondering, you know, we've got a full boat now on the Environmental Policy Board. We have a full boat on affordable housing yet, or is still one more short? Anyway, I'm just wondering if we do get continued expressions of interest, I would hate to be turning village residents away. So let's think alternates might be a good way to do it, expanding some of these boards to, you know, 5 to 7 members. I don't, you know, whatever approach we might want to take, but I'd hate to turn potential volunteers away.
So I would like to just stay on that. So I know we're making this concerted effort to find volunteers, but, you know, as we saw tonight, we're having a tough time populating that landlord-tenant relations council, and then the shade tree. We don't have a full board there. So, but we still have a deadline. I forget what it is when we're going to consider giving the village board discretion to appoint other New Paltz residents to these boards. What's the deadline that we're working with?
I want to say it was 2 months. Is that what you would propose?
Was it the end of September, something like that?
That sounds about right.
Mm-hmm.
And I am confident we should be in good shape with all our committees by then.
I'm impressed with the work done so far.
So we really need to put an effort towards populating that landlord-tenant council.
There was a letter to the editor on that subject in the first edition of the Oracle this year, asking for student volunteers. So hopefully that will.
We got a landlord volunteer, but she's a longtime New Paltz resident, and she expressed serious interest, but she doesn't live in the village. So I told her to send in her information, and maybe we'd get back to her, similar to the young woman we met with earlier.
I think if there's any board that we should consider letting non-village residents serve on, it would be the landlords that own property in the village, because they're very much stakeholders in the conversation.
So what are you suggesting that we would consider?
I think that board specifically, because there are so few landlords that reside within the village. This has been a problem. When I was interviewed at this table for the Environmental Policy Commission years ago, Sally got very excited because I was not a tenant nor a landlord and I could share that commission, but that did not come to be. I was very happy to be on the Environmental Policy Commission. So it just, if it's been an issue for many years getting landlords, I think that might be the one we would specifically have to really take a hard look at, letting non-village residents.
Okay. So can we put that on the well, this is still part of our initiative to find members. So I think before we consider non-village residents for even that landlord-tenant board, do you want to wait until we, you know?
Yeah, we gave Don 2 months. I think we should let him.
Okay. All right. So next item 21, consideration of Green Mountain Agreement. Did we get anything from? Okay, so you'll follow up. And then it seems like Tom just gave us an update on 22 short-term vacation rental.
I'll give
he
you
was waiting.
Another quickie.
Yeah.
I have a text that will send to me, but there were a couple of items in the text that I was not so comfortable with until I was able to have a discussion with him. You may know I was out of town again. Including yesterday. So today I did finally have an opportunity to talk with Will. And he assures me that an apparent discrepancy about what is the definition of short term is not necessarily fatal, that the definition of short term can be different in different local laws.
So in this instance, he's suggesting in concert with other municipalities, including in New York State, that short-term mean 30 days or less, or less than 30 days, I think it is. Whereas in another place in our code, it says less than 60 days, which is quite extraordinary, you know, because you could have a 59-day agreement and still be considered short-term. But in this instance, it would be less than 30 days. And he said this is not a fatal issue. And then I was also concerned that there was not specific reference to smoke alarms and fire extinguishers and so forth in the draft. And he pointed to me to other places where it says that people, or that those who are renters, would still have to comply with all state and other relevant legislation concerning fire safety. So if that's in there and it's clear to everybody that these are the regulations that are relevant, we don't need to repeat them here. It says that they have to comply with all such regulations. So with those two provisos, I would have this copied and sent to all of you for your consideration. Oh, and I might also point out one last thing. New York State is preparing to, the legislature has already passed a bill. The governor has not yet signed it, although he says he's preparing to sign it. Airbnb is preparing to sue the state of New York to delay any implementation of it. So we don't know what's going to happen with that stuff.
Okay. Next item, we had already voted on this previously. This is the amendment to the IMA between the town and the village regarding the sale of water. And a mistake was made in that I think the agreement was extended to 99 years and water agreements can't go beyond 40. So this new version is a 40-year agreement with an automatic resetting option of another 40. And this is important because I think the earlier version, the DEP was looking for a right of first refusal to buy back the property at 101 Plains Road, but they no longer need the right of first refusal if the IMA is long enough. So.
So the proposal now is the 40 plus 40.
Yeah. So.
And this is just this is an amendment to an already existing IMA.
Right. And we had already agreed on this concept previously, but
yes.
Now we're refining it so it actually works legally.
Well, I move that we adopt this.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Was that? Did you vote, Don?
I did.
Okay. Playground update. I have an update on ball courts. Dennis, did you want to update anything?
Well, yeah, the Play Everywhere Challenge, unfortunately, we were not selected as a finalist. So we take their $500 that they sent us as making it through the first round, and we bid them adieu. I would like to thank village resident Michael Saz for the graphic design work he did on our application, all pro bono, which is why we get to keep that $500. Thank you, Michael. You had ball court updates.
Yeah, so I met with Justin Dates and George Seafree this morning at the ball courts, and Justin's done a really great job of refining this concept. It's not a whole lot different than the site plan that I've shared with this board previously. We were just refining some of the distances between the baselines of the pickleball courts and the fencing. One of the nice features about this is there'll be a sidewalk feature that goes along the pickleball courts up to the playground at Hasbrook, but it's looking really sharp. One thing that's a little bit daunting though is how much will this all cost? So we now have a good level of detail. And so we've asked Justin, since he is a landscape architect, just to put together an estimate for us. But then it seems like we could then look for folks in the community to make contributions to this project. We've gotten a lot, I've personally heard from a lot of folks who are very supportive of improved pickleball courts. So we'll see how much the estimate is for this detailed plan that Justin has worked out. And then I've also been trying to figure out from the Public Works guys what they could offer as in-kind service. And I met with Nick Coddington today about, you know, which pieces of the project that they would be able to offer. I was going to just articulate some of those things in a note and then share that with the board as well as with Justin and George Seafree, just so we have some record of it. So I'll get to that. Any questions on that project? Next item, number 25, sidewalk update. Unfortunately, there are three properties along Church Street between Mulberry and Henry W. that we would require to get easements. And I continue to be blown away by how much it costs to just do anything. And when you need to get an easement and you're using federal dollars, there's very involved legal requirements. And we've actually even pushed back and asked the DOT if there's any way to work around this. And they said, absolutely not. And the way it would work is it would cost about $8,000 per easement. And I think with the plan that we've been working on, it involves four easements. So it seems like the path of least resistance may be to remove that section of Church Street, unfortunately, between Mulberry and Henry W., because that would be $24,000 just to go to a lawyer to create some easement, just so we could be the recipient of those federal dollars. So that's where we're at, and the engineer that we're working with is going to reprice the project if we remove Church Street and see if that works. So that was disappointing news, but I don't know how else we could make sense of using the federal dollars.
It is disappointing.
Strings attached. Or I guess it's not really strings, it's more, I don't know what it is. Anyways, next item, bike lane on Mulberry. I have not spoken with Blue to get his opinion on this. I think this continues to be on our agenda because we were looking for some sort of comment for that section of Mulberry between Church and I guess it would be all the way down to the rail trail, and just if Blue had any useful feedback regarding that concept.
I'd like to say that from a bike ped committee perspective, that is, I think, a very good concept. It's a useful direction to take. As you all know, it's difficult for cyclists and pedestrians to go down Henry D and then make the right turn at that corner and then make the left turn to go across North Chestnut Street. Going on Mulberry to, or going on Church to Mulberry, and then going down Mulberry and heading straight across, mm-hmm. while it's not a piece of cake, is a much easier mission. So a bike lane on Church over to Mulberry would be useful.
Alex, didn't you send a note to Blue asking for some comment?
Yeah.
I think I just need to remember to ask him about it, but maybe you can remind me again.
I think that would also be a good spot to put in some striping for a crosswalk. If you can have one on either side.
Where are you envisioning this crosswalk? On which street?
Mulberry.
On Mulberry.
To cross Chestnut. Because there aren't many crosswalks. Well, there's one at on Broadhead, and there's one down by Stewart's. But that's a, that would be a good spot for kids.
So to get you across North Chestnut at Mulberry. Okay.
Yes.
Got it. So that's a state highway.
Mm-hmm. That's the problem.
That would be a
big
TIC
request.
Ask. Yeah.
Yes.
Next item is a resolution of support for the Standing Rock Sioux Nation's resistance to the Dakota Access Pipeline. Dennis, did you want to comment on that since you...
Yes, I wrote this last week, and of course now it is outdated as President Obama has since halted action temporarily while they go through environmental review, so it is still an issue to comment upon. So I would actually like to amend the resolution where it says, therefore it is hereby resolved that the mayor and the village of board of the village of New Paltz stand in support of the indigenous opposition to the Dakota Access Pipeline, commend President Obama for his recent actions halting any further work on the pipeline for environmental review, and furthermore called upon the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers to revoke all permits allowing constructions for the fracked oil pipeline.
Second.
So, there we go.
Aye.
There's a mouth.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thanks, Dennis. Thanks for that.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
Yeah, thank you.
Amendment,
Dennis.
Too.
Yeah.
The next item is a letter of support. We actually submitted this, but we were looking to just have an official record that the village signed off in support of the town's application to the Hudson River Valley Greenway through the 2016 Hudson River Valley Greenway Community Grant Program for the Route 299 Gateway Planning and Zoning Project. So in more concise terms, the town was looking to Greenway for a planning grant to pay for the moratorium concept. So we sent a note supporting that effort. And next item is David Gilmore and I have been looking pretty hard at the Restore New York grant application opportunities and trying to see if it made sense. We actually, a while ago, submitted a letter of intent, and then we really looked at it more closely, and we don't think it's a great program for the project that we're interested in, but the project has to do with having a bicycle and pedestrian bridge from the parking lot at the wastewater treatment plant that would go on to the Huguenot Street property and kind of go along the back of the Huguenot Street property and end up behind the old fort on Huguenot Street. This idea actually came from some brainstorming sessions with Open Space Institute and Marietta from Huguenot Street and myself. And we're gonna see if we could articulate this concept, and I think it's very valuable to have plans and then basically use the plan to seek out grant money to realize the plan. So basically what I'm doing here is just letting you know that we're not going to apply for the Restore New York grant, but we are going to continue to have our planner articulate a plan for this project. And David and I both think it's a really exciting project because it really supports Huguenot Street, as well as giving people better access to the parking at the sewage treatment plant. It's really a downtown commercial vitality play. So I think it's a great project for a variety of reasons. So, you know, let's get it down on paper. Any questions? Nope. Next item, New Paltz Emergency Preparedness Plan. So we're looking for adoption of this plan. Any questions?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Let's do approval of the resolution of bills and claims.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, on to the items that I added. Don asked for an update on the Muni Center. I've been talking about this for a while. I really feel like it's too expensive for the town or the village or either one individually to build a Muni Center just using taxpayer dollars. I think we got to think outside the box and pursue a public-private partnership and maybe partner with another developer or property owner. And there are a couple of property owners that I've spoken with, two individually, and I can share those things, but I prefer not to do it publicly since it's really early goings. And then the third concept, which I continue to think is a viable idea, and that was working with the town to harness the grant opportunity for senior affordable housing at the Veterans Drive, and is there an opportunity to build out a municipal building that also has senior affordable housing at the Veterans Drive site? So I think we'll probably be talking about that tomorrow evening at our joint meeting.
Well, what I wanted to talk about a little bit, and I don't, you know, I'm very understanding of the fact that there are some developers you're in discussion with, and we don't want to talk about anything about along those lines too early in the process and scare anyone off or anything. But I think we had spoken in the past about development of a request for proposal on a project of this sort. And I know we'd seen a terms sheet that had resulted from one particular potential project. But I would like this board to develop a vision of what we want, rather than responding to any particular developer's proposal. I'd like to identify what it is we want out of this location and begin to develop, and then ultimately issue a request for proposal so that we have the widest possible number of options. And I think if we did develop a request for proposal, any developers who are looking at any project in this area would have some guidance and would be able to tailor their project to come to agreement with whatever it is we decide we want. But we haven't had that conversation as a board yet, and if we don't discuss this as a board, we're going to end up following someone else's lead, and I'd prefer not to do that.
So you're suggesting that we come up with a concept for what we want to see built on this property?
I think if we're open to proposals, and if we're open to proposals with regard to this property or surrounding properties, I think it's a good idea for us to define what those proposals should look like before we find them in our lab.
But we can't do an RFP for neighboring properties unless we had an agreement with that private property owner.
The village owns quite a bit of property in this area, including the location we're sitting in now, but also some adjoining spaces, parking lots, and things. That's part of the conversation. What we own do we want to have open to future projects? What do we not? If we want, once we define that within the area we've defined, what is it that we seek? What is it that we want? We know we want a town, village, municipal center, but what else do we want? And I think it's preferable for us to define that rather than someone to define that by a proposal that comes in. That's all I'm saying. If we define the terms, we know we're going to like what we get.
I think we could certainly do that. I mean, we have this property, plus we have the municipal center, plus the town owns the court property. So we could certainly draft an RFP and ask different developers to respond and see if they would build what we want built. That's certainly one way to go, absolutely.
Can we have that conversation at an upcoming meeting and start to develop some broad parameters? I don't want to do it now.
Yeah. Sounds.
I like this idea. correct me if I'm wrong, but I hear you saying that we should come up with what is at least the minimum use. What do we want to have which does not preclude what other developers right. would come along with, but what's the minimum that we want? And a really smart developer does that plus whatever else they can propose to us and is reasonable.
Yeah, yeah, something pretty basic and, you know, general. Just sure. Okay.
Don, since you and I were both on whatever that was, weren't we on some sort of
executive committee? Yeah.
I'd like to update, you know, just as I offered before, I'd like to update you on some of these concepts of partnering with a private property owner, and I think it could fit nicely with your suggestion. So I would even be, you know, it's a 90-second conversation.
Mm-hmm.
Would be very willing to have that with you once this meeting adjourns.
I'm glad you brought that up. Does that committee still exist? What is that?
Yeah. No, I don't. I mean,
we voted to make it. It kind of just dissolved.
Yeah. I haven't met with.
So that would be another thing to define in the course of the conversation, how we as a board are going to approach this whole subject.
Well, we'll be at the joint meeting tomorrow. So if you would be willing to chat with me after this meeting, we can kind of brainstorm about a couple ideas. I would really appreciate that.
Okay.
So streetlights, we're looking to purchase our own streetlights, but then also engage a third party. We agreed recently to work with the consortium that,
number 10,
I'm drawing a blank on. Yeah, we kind of skipped over this, didn't we?
Yep. Number 10.
Much earlier in the agenda.
Yeah, but I didn't comment on anything regarding streetlights.
No, number 10. You didn't. You skipped right past it.
Yeah, and I had this on my, because this was kind of the addendum to number 10. I don't know why we skipped over it before, but I would like to just comment on this concept of streetlights. You know, one of the things that has been identified when we're looking at streetlights is that the village pays for the electricity and the lease for all of the 292 streetlights that we have. And then we all know that there's an A fund and a B fund in the town. And in the town, they have just north of 100 lights. So the town's A fund, which both village and town outside the village residents pays for those town outside the village lights. So I would just like to pose the question, is that fair? Or, you know, should all streetlights throughout New Paltz be paid for with the town's A fund? It's just something that was kind of unearthed during this conversation. Because for all intents and purposes, village residents are paying for lights in the village, and we're also paying for lights in the town outside the village. Whereas town outside the village residents are only paying for lights in the town outside the village. So, just kind of an interesting concept to chew on. And I ask that be put on the joint agenda.
I find it also interesting. I'm surprised we've never heard, I have never heard this explanation before. I know that there have been many issues over the years about the use of the A fund versus the B fund, but I've not heard it put so clearly that village residents pay for all the village lights. Nobody else pays for it. Town residents, including the village residents, pay for the lights that are outside the village. Correct?
Yes.
I think we should have that conversation.
Next item was, I was just going to give you an update on this stormwater infrastructure grant. So there are four locations, and the four locations totaled $1.3 million. And there's one section along Mohonk Avenue between Fairview and Wirtz. So we'd be looking for culvert replacement at that spot of 1,500 linear feet. Then a section of Plains Road between Water Street and Plains. That's a shorter section at 780 linear feet. And then Plattekill Avenue from all the way up at 32 down to Hasbrook needs stormwater culvert replacements. And then the culvert down at Sunset Ridge at the bottom of the hill near the Duzine School. So those are four grant applications that we submitted to Bridge New York for all different amounts, but all four of them equal $1.3 million. So we'll keep our fingers crossed that we get a positive response. And the Carmine-Liberta Bridge waterline bids came in higher than originally estimated. We estimated that the cost of that waterline would be $90,000. So they came in at $120,000, $40,000 more. So we'd be looking to source that money from the Governor's Office of Storm Recovery. And what we would need then is the board to give me authorization to change the contract with the county regarding these additional costs. So I'm looking for that.
So moved.
Anyone want a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And I also wanted to give the board a heads up that we are going to receive a proposal for a maintenance agreement from the county. And this has been discussed previously. So there will be lights on the cantilevered sidewalk at the Carmine-Liberta Bridge. And then the overlook, which is basically located where the abutment for the temporary bridge is, will turn into a spot to look out west towards the ridge, and there'll be some lighting. And the county planner was telling me that it's going to be truly amazing in terms of how it's designed with pavers and some lighting. But we're going to get a proposed agreement from the county where we're going to pay for the electricity and the maintenance. So I just wanted to give everyone a heads up.
Sounds great.
Yep. So then the next item is this concept of a zoning change for the properties along the rail trail between Water Street and Plains Road. This is just early goings. What I'm looking for from the board is, so there's a property owner who is interested in a mixed use reuse of an existing property. So, but that would require, because that's currently not zoned for that type of development, and what they would be looking for is a rezoning, probably making that gateway zoning, connecting it to the adjoining gateway district. So all I'm looking for from the board is, like, if anyone says, wow, that's the worst idea ever, I would absolutely never consider that kind of zoning change, or is this something that we would take under consideration?
This would essentially be what is on Water Street from Main Street to, what would that be?
Sojourner Truth?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so then you would have a continuation of the gateway zone from Main Street all the way. Because right now the gateway to the south ends at Water Street.
I'm really glad I have no idea who the individuals or people are involved, but it sounds like the village is being asked to change the zoning for the benefit of an individual property owner. And do we do that? I honestly don't know. Is that okay?
Well, we do that if we believe that there's a benefit to the community, if it encourages the kind of development that we want to see. It may or may not be the kind of development that we want to see.
This might be a good question just to throw by Will, just for his opinion.
Well, it's already been thrown by Will. So
okay.
this is what we're looking for is like, this developer is just interested in some indication from, like, it's kind of like if the developer was saying, like, they want to build a Ferris wheel at that location and we do not like Ferris wheels, then we would say absolutely not. But are we generally comfortable with the idea of mixed use in a location like that? that's all they're looking for at this point.
I believe that we've already looked into this, but just to confirm, there's no flood issue there. That's not in the floodplain.
Well, the name of the zone is the flood district.
and it has flooded.
So then this is a good question.
Yeah, I have friends who have been vacated from there when it flooded. So I don't know if it's so much of an issue now, but yeah.
Well, I'd kind of like to see what the zoning is now and what the proposed change would be in writing.
Yeah. Oh, you are not even close to like being asked to sign off on anything. All I'm doing is introducing the concept. Right.
I know, but even to understand the concept, I want to see something in writing.
Perfect. That's yeah. a very reasonable, yeah. okay. perfect response. So all I'm trying to do is just like move a concept forward. That's okay. it.
Well, I could be interested
doing it
in mixed use, especially if it could provide more affordable housing in the village. So if mixed use means more affordable housing, then that's a priority for me, and I would like to see us entertain that as long as there's no flood issue. If
yep.
there's a flood issue, then
absolutely.
But if there's no flood issue, then and there's a prospect of mixed use, including affordable housing, then I certainly want to hear more.
Definitely worth exploring.
Yeah, I think as Don said, you know, we're willing to take a look at something, but we need a plan.
What?
And I think all we were doing at this point is just to make sure that there's the possibility of a plan, not that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay,
Mr. Mayor, I would even say not so much a plan, which sounds like a little advanced. But what's the idea? You know, what's the big idea that would lead us to consider a zoning change?
That was a rhetorical question, right?
Yes.
Great.
The concept.
So next item is related to 212-13, not 23. I'd like to make a motion that we classify this action as unlisted for seeker. This was under the advice of our planner.
I don't have this on my list. What is this?
I added this to the agenda, but this is related to the public hearing. You know, we've received a memo on this previously from our planner. I think it's in here too. Well, the okay.
So I just didn't make it on my list here. So you're talking about this item that we talked about here at the beginning of the meeting?
Yeah, it's the same okay. same thing, but here, you know, that was the public hearing, and this is the action.
Okay.
It just didn't make it to the agenda as an action. And I could also share that the county has reviewed this proposed law change, and their response was generally favorable, but we have not received anything in writing, and once we receive something in writing, we can move forward with the proposed law. But I can share that their review was generally favorable.
I'll make that motion.
Second, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. I think that's all I have.
Social media.
Yes.
Which one?
We the last
added.
Item.
Oh, got it. Watch Dennis add it. Yeah.
Was that you?
That was me.
Yeah.
So this actually came out of a conversation I was having with the mayor the other day. And just about getting additional public perspective on contested items, things that we would just like to get more information, and we think that using Facebook polls might be a good way to do it. The only problem is there's kind of an art to polling. If you're looking for certain results, you can tailor your question in a way to try and skew how the poll results are gonna come through. So it almost begs that we have some sort of a process in place before we start doing that. And then furthermore, thinking about it even further beyond that, I was, you know, and currently the mayor has access to our Facebook page. I believe he uses it very responsibly. It's a very great tool that he uses to get information out.
Yeah, Rebecca and I both do.
Oh, you also have access? Oh, man. So we're out of the loop.
Sorry, guys.
That's okay. That's okay. But you see what I'm saying? There is the potential for people to use social media to push their own agenda other than board agenda. And I just want to stress, our board has been fully responsible to this point in this regard. This is not reactive to anything. This is more about creating healthy process for the future. So I would like to try and tailor some sort of a policy for that and bring it back to the board. I just want to see straw poll, kind of what we were doing on Water Street a moment ago, making sure we're not wasting any time before fleshing something out. So general thoughts?
Now, I use Facebook a lot, but I don't use either this Facebook site or the New Paul's Facebook site. I stay off of both of those. I meditate instead of those. But I use it a lot for other purposes, and it's actually very effective in communication. But I've never done anything like a questionnaire that draws a response from a large number of people. So I have no knowledge of how that works.
Well, there are other tools as well which we could share on Facebook where people can link to something like a SurveyMonkey. There's one program that's called SurveyMonkey.
Yes, and I know SurveyMonkey.
There's a number of them that I have used before. So I would be more than willing to work with you on a project.
I'm supportive of it. I do have concern with an increase on the workload of the clerk office, who would ultimately be maintaining these things.
It's really
someone's got. If you have a Facebook page, you have a someone's. I mean, I don't think a trustee's doing.
Yeah, it's not that hard.
We already have a Facebook page.
We have a Facebook
page. Rebecca and I both put info on it.
And also, if we were to do something like a SurveyMonkey. There really isn't any maintenance. What you're doing, you can put an end date on a survey, and what you're getting back is a tally of responses. You can have responses where, say, what do you think about, you know, a crosswalk, you know, and rank it 1 to 5, and you can ask short answer questions where you're eliminating an answer to a sentence, even, and it tallies up really easily. So.
Well, you know that world better than I do. If you don't think it's an extra burden on the clerk's office, I'm okay.
I mean, I regularly ask Alex to post something informative. She's like super nimble with getting info out via our website or via Facebook. I mean, I think we generally use Facebook to just share basic information.
Right.
But this is another potential use, right? Like, mm-hmm. we could collect other information via a poll.
Yes.
And that's where it starts getting sticky, because you can influence polls based on how you pose the questions.
Yeah. And you also wouldn't get an answer from me.
Right, you're only getting an answer from people who are more active on Facebook.
Yeah.
Right, you're only getting a certain cross section of the community, but it is a good way to get additional feedback. You know, one of the things that I hear from various boards and commissions is, how come we never hear from the public until we decide to do something, and then everyone comes to us with their feedback?
Right.
And I think part of that responsibility is on us to get more information out there and to solicit more feedback in advance. It's just a matter of doing it in a healthy, ethical way. So let's create guidelines so that way there's no question.
Generally in agreement.
Excellent. Thank you. I'd like to motion adjourn.
Second.
Aye. I had a quick question before we adjourn. Because I know we usually go right there, and it's like I wouldn't have a chance to breathe before.
We're not in quorum anymore.
Are we going to be talking to more hydrologists in future meetings? Or I think we could talk.
I like the idea of, you know, maybe we could get like even record a discussion with a couple of hydrologists. You know, not necessarily do it on a Wednesday night if we could get. you know, at least two board members in the room. And then we could record it and, you know, that
I'm okay with that. Yeah, I know we talked about a number of hydrologists and, you know, this went a little long tonight. I understand that.
I just want, you know, that I was in pain.
Yeah, but Tom, I also, you know, this is painful work, municipal work. And unfortunately, I think sometimes it's not just about us, but it's also like letting the public hear that type of discussion. I was okay with that presentation for that type of reason.
I was not.
You've heard it all before. You already know this stuff.
Well, I put in 3 years of pain. So.
Thank you for your pain, Tom.
Sufficient.
And conservation easement will be on the next agenda?
Well, we got a response from Will. He had some issues with
I read it.
A lot of the proposed language. Right.
I saw that. I'm hoping that we would see a modified version before the board, before any further meetings. The draft I saw was not in any way responsive to a recent unanimous vote of the board. And I sure don't want to see that come to us at the next meeting in that form.
You mean in this particular format that we got from Will now?
Yeah.
And I'm so not if you think there was anything missing, contact Will and tell him you want him to focus harder on that language.
Okay, we'll do that.
I'll move that we adjourn.
Second.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All of us.
Didn't we already adjourn?
No.
Oh,
now we are adjourned. Yes.
Americans have shown that they really prefer an elected official who speaks his mind.